Thanks for clicking on this video. My name is Trey Durden. I'm with the Beltline Church of Christ. I'd like to address something that is talked about in Psalm 42. We'll be looking specifically from verses 3 to 6 and just considering something that's said there. Actually, something in modern day therapy is found right here in this ancient text. The idea of talk therapy or cognitive behavioral therapy is something that is brought out right here. But in this text and in the way that a spiritually minded person would go about it is much more godly. It's something that would direct our heart rather than getting in touch with ourselves. It would direct our hearts to get in touch with God. So I'd like for us to read that together and then make a few observations. In Psalm 42, starting in verse 3, it says, "My tears have been my food day and night, while people say to me all day long, 'Where is your God?' These things I remember as I pour out my soul, how I used to go to the house of God under the protection of the Mighty One, with shouts of joy and praise among the festive throng. Why, my soul, are you downcast? Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise Him, my Savior and my God. My soul is downcast within me, therefore I will remember you." He says, I will remember God when I'm downcast, when I'm feeling bad, when that spiritual depression comes upon me. I'm going to say, now wait a second, let's remember who I serve. Let's remember who I belong to. I want to encourage you, in times when you are starting to feel that spiritual depression come on, when the circumstances that are going on around you start to get to you, to remind yourself, to speak to yourself, talk to yourself even, and to pour out your soul. There in Psalm 42 and verse 4, that's the first step, isn't it? He says, I'm going to pour out my soul. And he thinks about how he used to go to worship and how it was so wonderful to gather with the crowd of people who also wanted to worship God. And all of us are missing that togetherness and that fellowship during this time of quarantine. And we remember what it was like. And sometimes our hearts, they're saddened within us. We're downcast because we don't get to do some of the things we used to do. You know, this idea of pouring out your soul there in verse 4, it's a godly ancient version of getting in touch with your feelings. Rather than denying that these feelings of despondency exist, he's getting in touch. He's pouring out his soul. But he's not just pouring out his soul. He's not just getting in touch with his feelings. He's reminding himself that God is. He's reminding himself that God loves him and the plans that God has for him. As you go through this, you're reminded of these things. You know, we're told in the New Testament, in Philippians 4, 6, and 7, that we should give our requests, give our anxieties to God. In fact, in 1 Peter 5, 7, he tells us to cast our cares upon the Lord. He says, you give those over. You pour out your soul. Give those to the Lord because he can take care of those things. Those things that are out of our control. Those things that we don't really have the power to make big changes in societal evolution. Yet God does. God can change the course of things. And so pray to him. Pour out your soul to him. He's listening to the thoughts and the intentions of your heart. And he wants you to lay those before him. So pour out your soul. Secondly, I would encourage you to take part in a self-dialogue. Don't just listen to yourself. It's time to start talking back. It's time to start preaching to yourself, reminding yourselves of some things. You know, he speaks to himself here in verse 5. He says, oh, my soul, why, my soul, are you downcast? Why do you speak this way? Why do you feel this way? He says, why are you doing this? He's not praying to God here, and he's not speaking to his readers. He's talking to himself. This is a self-dialogue. This is the essence of how you, yourself, can really handle any of the stress, any of the anxiety, any of the circumstances that might come upon you in this life, even a pandemic. This is one technique that is found here in the Word of God of dealing with those things that are outside of our control. In fact, the preacher, David Martin Lloyd-Jones, he was speaking about this specific text. And something that he said I think is worthy for us to note. I heard Timothy Keller speaking about this recently. And he quoted David Martin Lloyd-Jones as saying this, The first thing we've got to learn is what the psalmist had learned. We must learn to take ourselves in hand. He's talking to himself. He is addressing himself. It is important to see that this is not the same as morbidity or an introspection. He then goes on to say, we must talk to ourselves instead of allowing ourselves to talk to us. In spiritual depression, we allow ourselves to talk instead of talking to ourselves. Am I being deliberately paradoxical, he asks? Far from it, he says. This is the very essence of wisdom in this matter. Have you realized that so much of the unhappiness in your life is due to the fact that you're listening to yourself instead of talking to yourself? So this man stands up and he says, self, listen for a moment. And then you must go on to remind yourself, as the psalmist did, of who God is, of what God is and what he's done and what God has pledged himself to do. And then on this great note, defy yourself. Say, no, heart, you're saying the wrong things. You're thinking the wrong things. You're headed in the wrong direction. Let's redirect and point ourselves towards God. He goes on to finish the quote. He says, defy yourself, defy other people, defy the devil and defy the whole world, and say with the psalmist, I shall yet praise him, for he is my God. What a quote. And it's true, isn't it? We need to talk to ourselves, to preach to ourselves even, remind ourselves of who God is, what he's done, and what he will continue to do in our lives. What a beautiful thing it is to pour our souls out before God, but then to remind ourselves of his words. That self-dialogue that really has its roots in the Word of God, where we listen to what God has to say to us. You know, when you listen to your heart, it's saying all kinds of panicky things, isn't it? In Jeremiah 17, verse 9, the Bible tells us that our heart is deceitful above all things. It'll lead us in the wrong direction. And you've heard often, instead of following your heart, lead your heart. Lead your heart to Jesus. Don't follow your heart wherever it wants to go. Instead, lead your heart to Jesus. Your heart's saying, oh no, this might happen, that might happen. Oh, this is never going to get better. Things are never going to change. And so when this happens, you turn and you say to yourself, you listen here. This is what I know about God. This is what he has planned. This is what God has promised. And I know he'll deliver. And you speak to your heart and you remind yourself of who God is. It'll center you. It'll help you come back to the place where you should be as you walk on the straight and narrow path that Jesus has set an example for us to follow. Let's follow Christ. You stop listening to your heart. Start talking to it. Start preaching to it. And you'll find more peace in this life. Last, I want to encourage you to reorder your hopes. Reorder your hopes. There in verses 5 and 6, he says that he's going to keep his trust in God, doesn't he? He says he's going to keep his trust in the one who he's always trusted, the one who's always delivered him, the one who will continue to deliver him. I'll keep my hope in God. This psalmist, he's redirecting what he puts his hopes in. Instead of keeping our hopes in the things of this world that change, instead of looking at how we might be able to control circumstances that are totally out of our control, and getting depressed about it, and getting worried about it, and letting anxiety drive us and our hearts take us somewhere where we don't want to be. He says, no, let's remember who's in charge. It's God. And that he has your best interest at heart. He wants what's best for you. Because as Christians, we already know. Now, I don't know what the psalmist knew when he wrote these things. Obviously, he knew something. He had his hope firmly grounded in God. But as Christians, we know so much more. We know that we have justification in Christ. In Romans chapter 8, starting in verse 29, it says, for those who God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son. He's predestined everyone whom he foreknew. And he foreknew all of us. He knew all of us before we were born. And his plan for all mankind was to be conformed to the image of his Son, to become more like Jesus in this life. And it says, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he is justified. And those whom he justified, he is glorified. What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He says, who can be against us when God has done all this for us? And then he goes on to say, he who did not spare his own Son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? This is God we're talking about. God, your Father, the one who loves you, and in whom you should live your life because you have your trust in Him, because you base your life on what He has said. You have justification in Christ. You have all these wonderful things. You have sanctification because of Christ through the Spirit as you grow in the graces of the Lord. As you listen carefully to His Word and as you speak that Word back to yourself in response to some of the things that you may be saying to yourself. Remember that you have adoption into God's family. You can reorder your hopes by remembering, wait a second, I've been adopted into the family of my Father God. I've been adopted into His family. Ephesians 1 and verse 5 says, you have this adoption into the family of God. And what about when I think about my personal future resurrection? Because I know what Jesus said. He said that He's going to prepare a place for us and that He will come again to take us to be with Him. That we're going to be with Him. In John 11, 25 and 26, as He's speaking to the sisters of Lazarus, right before Lazarus is raised from the dead, He says, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in Me will live even though they die. He says, even though you die, you're going to live. And whoever, He says in verse 26, whoever lives by believing in Me will never die. And He asks Mary, Martha, do you believe this? Well, that's a question for us today, isn't it? Do you believe this? Can you reorder your hopes and get them in line with what God has said about you? Because He's called you His own. He's called you His child. He's called you blessed. He's called you justified because of what Jesus did. He's called you sanctified because of the operation of the Holy Spirit in your life as you listen to the Word of God, and it changes you from the inside out, and it helps you to speak to your heart, to quiet those anxieties, to cast your care on Him. Yeah, I want to encourage you, pour out your soul. Have a self-dialogue where you speak truth and you speak life to yourself and you reorder your hopes on God, keeping your trust in Him. You see, self-talk, it reflects your beliefs. It reflects what you really think is true. And so the things that you're telling yourself, they're either moving you closer to God or further from Him. Which do you choose? Do you believe? Do you believe that Jesus Christ is the resurrection and the life? Do you believe that He has given Himself in order to save you? In order to redeem you from your sins? You see, the gospel of Christ, His death, burial, and resurrection, it's taught to us through the Scriptures today that we might die to ourselves in repentance, that we might be buried in baptism, that we might rise up out of that watery grave to walk a new life, a Christian life, a life that makes a difference now in the lives of others who we might influence. I want to encourage you, let's make sure our hopes are in the right place. And as we go through circumstances beyond our control, that we keep our trust and our Father who loves us so very much, that He would give us everything in order to redeem our lives. Will you pray with me? Dear Father, thank You so much. Help us to speak life to ourselves. Help us to remember Your words and to have confidence in Your promise. Help us to walk according to Your way and not according to our own. We love You, Father, and in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.